For a starter, if they face off one side or the other, like he's facing off this left-hand side, and then maybe he's got his hands up ready to defend himself, this is kind of a typical scenario. So we usually climb off the elbow. So if he's going here, we've got to climb off the elbow and just take someone down nice and easy, just sweep them out. Yeah, and again, one more time. So your guard's up here, and you push their weight back this way a little bit, so there's not much weight on the foot, and you're sweeping behind the foot. And you just take them down. And from there, we're going to keep the hand on the wrist, middle finger on, and thumb around the wrist, right at the joint, right at the joint of the wrist. And lifting on this side here stops him. You lift and you get slight compression down. That stops him from punching you in the groin, because if he's like that there, he can punch you in the groin and kill you. So we lift up that side here, and then you use your knees slightly there, and then you wing this elbow around here. We put on a 90 degree elbow joint lock, and we're just taking him over just gently here, and then we use our knees and we pull in with the knees. So the knees are kind of going like this here, and you go onto the edge of your feet. It's a really weird walk, this one, like that. We're here. But what that does is it puts most of the weight through your foot and through the person, or puts more weight on the person here, but we've got the person here, and I'm aware that his arm can only bend at 90 degrees because he's a muscly guy, he's done a lot of power training. And if you drop your elbow to the centre line, you're not going to fall over the top. If you have your legs like this, you can fall over the top as well. So this is a no-no. This puts too much weight through the person. This is more gentle, and it avoids, even though it looks like I'm on his neck, my weight is not going through his neck at all. If you put the weight through the neck here, this is the wrong thing to do. You've got too much weight going through the spine, and it's not good for the person. So we go to here. In this case, what I'll be doing is I'll just be rocking him so I can get the other hand out. We'll put the other hand behind the back, and then we'll sit in here closer. So I've got both the hands sitting together, so I can take one hand off and reach for the handcuffs and cuff the person. Once you've got the person cuffed, there's no reason why they should be down on the ground, really. Once you've got the person cuffed, they should be up and away to a car, or you walk the person away, because you don't really want to have the person on the ground any longer around a crowd of people, because someone could come in and kick him. Someone has got to watch my back while I'm doing this. You need an officer or a guard to be watching your back, so no one comes in and kicks you from behind as well. Even though, because of my stance, I've got peripheral vision, I can see around me, you know, 270 degrees, I just can't see directly behind me. So when you need to sit them up, you just, from here, just roll them to their butt and then help them up. Yep, and you just stand up by yourself here. That's it. And you're going them so they don't turn around and headbutt you. And you can just, from here, you can just walk them like that there. If you walk tight to them, it's safer. It's safer because you can lift the arm. If you walk a long way from a person, they can actually kick out your leg and break your leg. So if you walk tight to a person, just jam it. If they do anything wrong, if they go to kick you or something, you jam them behind here and you'll take them down again. Because I can lift them and take them backwards again on the ground. Okay. Now, anything you... So, my guard is, wings are in, and I've got two hands to defend, because he's probably gonna strike with that one first and go for the other one. So I've got to go on the same stance as him. If he's on the left stance, I've got to be on a right stance, and the line of my foot is outside the line of his foot, so that if anything, I can just push across. So if I crowd him from here, if the line of my foot is outside the line of his foot, the most basic thing is that I can push his elbow into his body here, sweep his leg out, take him down. That's the most basic thing. Then as soon as he's down, I'm tilting him over so he's slightly leaning that way, rather than him being here, like I said before, and punching you. Yeah? You lead them across, and then you push weight pressure down through the body here, and then jam it, lock it tight. And you put on a wrist lock here, just a gentle one, and it's a compression wrist lock. It's like from here, hand the hand around the corner of the elbow, there's your wrist lock there if you want to apply pressure. You don't have to apply pressure, but it's just safer. And I'm controlling the hip with the edge of my knee and the edge of this knee. I'm not using the front of the knees like this here, I'm using the edge and squeezing in and pushing down gently. And I've got good vision from here. You've got good vision, it's quite safe. Yeah, and it's quite controlled, isn't it? It's not too painful for you, but it's got the point across from him. If he was kind of exothermic, kind of exploding with anger, like a lot of people do, to be put in a position like this is quite humbling. You kind of really think about what you want to do. If they're still mouthing off, you just tweak the wrist just to give them the idea. If they're still mouthing off that you're giving you a hard time, you can always tweak it and wind it in like that there until they get the understanding that they're under control. But from here, taking it down this way here, you must have someone to watch your back. I mean, this is so important. If they haven't got someone to watch your back, I find I'll just walk around the body from here, like this, and take a person here, and then just do a standing restraint like this until you get some help, until you call over help. And from this one here, you put your foot under the armpit, and you edge your foot forward, and you keep this arm straight, and it's locked. And this is a good one because it's a quick release. You can tack off with this half a dozen of his mates that want to have your blood in for restraining this person. But also that you're not really hurting the person badly if you restrain a person like that, because you know, his mates can't get too upset. It's not like you're doing anything too damaging, and you feel like you still have your respect. You know, kind of, you've been taken down, you've been humbled, but it's not like you've lost teeth. And you know, he's been beaten up in the process. It's pretty gentle. Yeah, I think that's part of the game, is communication and communication with.
Well, you've got those other techniques there in case I don't comply. The compliance techniques.
Yes.
With the joints.
There's always a threat of compliance techniques, and it's no good to whine on the pain too much, especially if they've been intoxicated, because they don't feel the pain that much.
Or drugs.
Yeah. Or drugs. But that's why a joint lock only works if it's structural. So that was a structural joint lock, because I was doing the arm lock. The wrist locks don't work so well, I feel. The more intoxicated they are, the less likely they are to work well. And I prefer the, you know, body locking positions and immobilizing using the edge of the knees for safety factor in that. Yeah. Covered quite a bit of ground. Thank you very much, Bryn. All right.